Welcome to the Executive Insights podcast, where we talk about insights that we have gotten from our customers worldwide. I am Tom Soderstrom. I'm an enterprise strategist, and with me is
Miriam McLemore, also an enterprise strategist.
We're part of a group that has led transformation for our respective companies or agencies, and Miriam very impressively did
Coca-Cola,
and I did Jet Propulsion Laboratory and NASA.
Just NASA. No big deal.
Just the cloud thing. So if you are watching this, and we think you will get something out of it, especially if you're a business leader, or if you're in IT worrying about what's going to happen with all this data, or if you're just trying to figure out how to rise through the organization and probably hit the biggest thing that's happening, which is data, and what can we do with it? Now, Gartner studies are saying most people are not happy with their insights of data. So when I ask the executive leaders, I say, what do you think about data? So I hear, intuitively, I know the data is the lifeblood of my organization, but I'm overwhelmed. I don't know what to do. How much should I spend? How much can I spend? What should I do? Or I have all this data, some I know of and some I don't. Can I monetize it? Or is the quality of my data good enough? Should I just wait for it to be perfect? Or how much is it growing? And I'll come back to how much it's growing. It's pretty astronomical. What are some quotes you're hearing from your customers?
You know, the issue that I've seen with customers is up till now, we've relied on structured data because that's what fit in our tables. That's what we could calculate. That's what we could populate to dashboards reliably with accuracy. But there's this huge and growing world of unstructured data that customers are looking for access to. And the world of Agentic gives you the possibility to leverage that unstructured data and integrate it with the structured data. But those are new metrics for business leaders. This is a different way of assessing your organization, the place you play in, the opportunities and outcomes that you can drive. So the questions I'm getting from customers is, you know, where do I start?
Yeah.
I'm overwhelmed. I have a bunch of the structured stuff. There's all of this unstructured. Where do I begin?
Yeah, it's paralyzing for them.
It is.
And I thought I would pull some actual quotes of data.
Yeah.
I did a podcast with Milan Thompson-Bukovec, who owns data. So she gave me some interesting stats about S3, our primary data source. It has 1 million data lakes on S3, holds 1 trillion objects, has many, many exabytes, averages 150 million requests per second, has thousands of customers that store more than 1 petabyte, several that store more than an exabyte. For a business executive, this is exciting. Look at all the stuff I own. For an IT person, this is horrifying. How do I manage it? So I think the growth of data, and I think you said it well, where do I start? Just start.
Yeah.
And 10% is structured, the rest is unstructured. But with agentic AI and generative AI, you can take advantage of it. So I think that's something we're going to talk about, successes and failures going forward.
Well, it's interesting, Tom, at least I'm finding that financial services, insurance, and some spaces, healthcare, are jumping in faster because their data has had to be clean. They spent a lot of time on accuracy, integrity of their data. Other organizations have a lot of data silos and inconsistencies in their data. So there's data cleansing, there's data governance that they have to put in place to leverage this new technology. Is that?
Yeah, it mirrors what I'm hearing from, we both deal with customers across the world, large customers, and anybody who's really regulated, we see that as a disadvantage, but it's not. It's an advantage because they already know how to deal with their data. Public sector, where I grew up, certainly does. So I thought maybe what we would do is just talk about some of our customers that we've seen done it incorrectly.
Yeah.
And some that we can learn from that have done it correctly. And then maybe we'll cover some actual customer examples with names.
Yeah.
Do you dare?
Sure.
All right. unsuccessful, they create too much friction. I see this all the time. This person who owns the data, quote, owns the data, doesn't want to share it.
Yes.
If you want my data, you have to fill out a form. In fact, two or three forms.
Yep.
So, but we want everybody to use the data. So what's the answer? Flip the script.
Yes.
If I need to protect my data, I fill out a form. And it's an easy thing to do. And for instance, at one big space agency, we noticed they spent as much money protecting the cafeteria menu as spacecraft uplink commands.
Yeah.
But you don't know that until you look, until you see.
It is fascinating because we were in a world where data was power. Right. If you own the data, you control the data. And I had that, you know, with the functions that I was interacting with, finance were the only people who could see the finance data. The people in science were the only people that could see that data. And so these silos perpetuated themselves because it became a culture within those organizations that it's not safe to share. So I love this concept of flipping the script and talking about the value, and data is an organizational asset. It's not a functional asset.
We had talked about coming up with an organizational data mesh.
Yep.
Where it's really about incentives. Mm-hmm. It's about the people who want to use the data really want to use it. The ones who want produce the data want people to use it. So why doesn't it happen? So you need somebody in the middle that just makes it happen and make it incentivized.
Yeah.
Remove the friction.
And sometimes the data governance can become the friction.
Yes.
So you also have to do that the right way, because I agree with you. There are producers of data and consumers of data. But in the middle, you do need the ability to manage that data and govern the data and have the right security, the right identity and access management controls. All of that is absolutely important. We're not saying it needs to be a free-for-all.
Right.
We're saying that you've got to bring insights together to drive outcomes. It's interesting. I had the great opportunity to attend a Formula One event just recently. They are such an amazing example of being data-driven as teams, as drivers, and as the F1 organization. And what I appreciated about them, which is a tenet that I believe many organizations can take, is nothing, no sensor, no data insight is added to a car or added to the screen, because these are split into millisecond decisions that need to be made. And so they ruthlessly prioritize what insight matters, what actually drives a business outcome. Because, of course, in Formula One, speed matters.
Yeah. In fact, of all the executives I've talked to this year, and I'm sure you too, the number one priority is speed.
Speed to
market, speed to profitability, speed to compliance, speed to skills. And the data can help all that. It's an exciting, exciting time. The other thing I'm seeing that companies do wrong is they're trying to be perfect. And like your Formula One example, if you were just theoretical and never tested it, you wouldn't know.
Right.
So it started with a business use case and try it and iterate and expect the first version to be the worst and the most expensive.
Right.
And then you can move forward. But data really enables all of these other things. And we're going to talk about Agentic very shortly.
Yeah, but that culture of experimentation, I just don't want to leave that important point, because as we lean into integrating more data, you have to have a culture in your organization that allows for us to learn and take those improvements. That's what Agentic does, right? These agents are self-improving agents. They'll see what the path was, and they'll start to learn, is there a better path? And we have to also have that culture inside our organizations.
Yes. And again, with the incentives, sounds like that's what F1 did, work backwards. What's the end result that I want? How can I get there? And how can my data help me? Lonely Planet took their petabytes of data and they organized it. They used generative AI and they came up with this virtual travel agent. Coney Elevators, a Finnish company.
Yep.
Hundreds of thousands of elevators. The person goes out to fix it and they have all the information at their fingertip. So I think one of the things that we see through all of these is that everything is data. Code is data. Now, Amazon upgraded all the Java. Sounds boring. It's expensive. 3,500 workdays were saved. $250 million saved by using generative AI and agents and treating the code as data. It's a fascinating new world. What's your favorite agentic example?
Well, I actually like the one you just mentioned with Lonely Planet, maybe because I travel a lot. And, you know, what they've done is really get clear on the traveler's need, right? What does the traveler need in a travel agent?
Yeah.
What's the help that they're asking for? Where should I stay? Where should I eat? How do you make my life simple? What's the Uber equivalent in this country? Right? Help me travel and make that simple for me and use data. And that's one of the things that I love about the Lonely Planet example.
Another example that I really like is NASA data is now on AWS Data Exchange, and it can now help predict floods in Australia, droughts in Africa, because everybody can access it. A professor at University of Sydney put all of her genomics data on Open Data Exchange, and a researcher in Sweden solved how to help save the koala. So it's just this global
I love that.
Help. So if you were going to give advice to the future leaders who now is going to manage this, what would you do? What would you say?
Yeah, I had roles where, you know, I was the kind of data czar. And we were always, because I worked in a global business, and we were always trying to bring data together. But we were doing it for the purposes of reporting, because from a finance standpoint, we had to report consistently. And so that was a reasonably good reason, but it didn't drive business. And so what I would encourage new leaders today is to start with what are you trying to accomplish? What is the business need you're trying to drive? Like, you know, I mentioned F1, bringing down a pit stop from what it was, I think, in the 50s, 67 seconds. Mm-hmm. A pit stop can now be accomplished in 1.8 seconds.
That's amazing.
Just doesn't even seem possible.
Yeah.
But it is about taking out all the things that don't matter and only focusing on the things that do, and then coordinating them to the millisecond. And so how do we do that in business? And so leaders being inspired to drive business outcomes and constantly improve. I think it's an exciting world.
Yeah, it is an exciting world.
To be a leader.
And I really agree what you said. Focus on the things that matter. That goes with data too.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it. Just use the data that you can use to create this outcome, work backwards, and focus on that. And the rest will come. These future leaders have to show results all the time.
Yes.
And that comes from a culture of experimentation and just iterating. And I would say for the data owners out there, they feel they are controlled with data, use that to drive these new generative AI and agentic results.
Yes.
Show business outcome.
And to your point about leadership, we've got to start at the top, get the leaders engaged, but we've got to come up from the bottom too and upskill so that we meet in the middle as an integrated team.
Thank you very much. Thanks for teaching me yet again. I appreciate it.
I always enjoy my conversations with you, Tom.
Thank you.